There he is! He's right here! I could see him. He's sitting here. Oh, look, 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 look now! Wait until he will move. Here! He's looking at us. Left to that big gray rock. He's just sitting there. There.
Away from the leaf.
Look, look now on the big rock! On the big rock.
He's huge.
Yeah, they are huge. Wow. Oh, that's awesome.
Oh, that looks like ugly.
They can come close to you. They are...
I'm sure they're easy to hit.
They are not that wild. And there is another one.
Big.
And there is another one. They are many.
They probably live in that, like, in that rock, well, in the cave thing there.
Yeah. They live in those holes. It's a one big family. They are awesome. They are really awesome. be the Mont Blanc. Might be.
Thank you. Thank you.
Awesome. Fucking hell.
Jesus.
We just made over 800 meters ascending in less than five kilometers of distance. Fuck you. Fucking hell. And there is Italy, and here over this hill, there's Switzerland. Fuck this shit.
Rebo, relax dneska dej. Relaxační, že?
Ty vlá se poseru.
Making smiley, happy, not even breaking a sweat. It's not bad. Kurva teko.
Fuck this shit. But that's it.
Už tam jsme, že? Skoro. Paráda.
Tady už je.
Jo. Boží.
Švýcarsko posrané.
Hej, já jsem to tak teď počítala, že nám to vyšlo včera, plus minus boj očko, 200 vole na kilách stoupačka. Tyhle, to je mazezvě. Ale včera to bylo...
No to je tak teď, no, toto.
No toto bylo taky hodně prudké.
Ty vole.
Protože my jsme měli včera nástup, my jsme šli 5 kilometrů furt z kopce jenom do toho města, víš? Takže 5 kilometrů nic a dolů zase nějakých 10, možná 12, jo? Z 28, takže na 10, my jsme nastoupili 18 na 10 kilákách. To je jako dobré, že? Jako cítím trošku lejtka.
Thank you. Thank you. So finished Tour de Mont Blanc finally. What an adventure. Well, what's that? It's a trail around Mont Blanc, the highest mountain in Europe. And it starts in France and it goes through France, Italy, Switzerland, back to France, and you make a nice circle. It's around, I guess, 160 to 180 kilometers because it has many variants, so you can take many versions. There are some crossroads and you can take different paths. Usually there is a main path which most people take, but you can choose different variants, which are usually they are better views, but it's harder because there is much more elevation gain on those. Usually it takes around between like 7 to 12 days. I think most people, they make it around those 10 days. We made it in 7, but it was because we were in a hurry. So yeah, but I think 7 is the minimum if you want to enjoy the trail. It's around 25 kilometers per day, 20-25. We did in 2 days. 2 days we did 30 kilometers, but 2 days were shorter. We did around 15 or less than 20. And it's because of the place to sleep, because officially it's forbidden to camp, to wild camp anywhere in France, Italy and Switzerland. In Italy and France, I think it's tolerated when you hide somewhere or you just leave no trace and you choose some remote area. But in Switzerland, they check it, they control it, they are sending even drones, I think, and they are very huge fines. So that's what limits you. You have to go from place to place, for sleeping place to sleeping place. So and when I'm talking about those camps and refugios, that's actually not that easy, because for refugios you have to book them quite in advance, and they are fully booked 1 year ahead. So if you want to go on July, you have to book it on spring the previous year for the exact day. So that's very inconvenient. And so we were just wild camping, but sometimes camping in public camps, paid camps, campsites, which is like a compromise between wild camping and refugio. Usually you have showers there and a toilet, and it's easier. Actually, Tour de Mont Blanc was the first hike in my life when I didn't have to go to poop outside, you know, to the nature, because this is so well-known trail and all the infrastructure and everything is around. So you can just go from toilet to toilet. Those toilets, they are in refugios, on the way, on some public places, even on parking lots. So yeah, you could basically at least once per day use a toilet somewhere, which was very, very convenient. But on the other hand, there are so many people. I think they counted 10,000 hikers per year who are going to the Mont Blanc. And because it's in high mountains, there is a very, very narrow time frame when you can hike to the Mont Blanc. And it's usually July and August. So those 10,000 hikers in average, they are on the trail in those 2 months, which means that this trail is extremely, extremely crowded. Like, people were saying that it's very crowded, but it was way worse than I expected, and I expected that it would be very crowded. they are places where you see dozens of people at the same time somewhere around you. And apart for late evenings or early mornings, basically any time you look around on the path, you see someone, you see some hikers. So for me it was quite a shock after hiking Corfu trail in Greece, because that was completely opposite. There was nobody on the trail. You were all the time alone except for villages and civilization. But here they are people everywhere, and in campsites there are hundreds of people at the same time. I don't know how it's in refugees, because we didn't use that option. But yeah, it's very, very crowded hike. And this was a very big disadvantage for me, because I really like to go without people, to be alone. And I think that for this reason, there is a better alternative than to the Mont Blanc, and it's Alta Via in Dolomites. It's very similar in terms of landscape. They are very also high mountains, and those views are similar, but there should be less people. So I'm going to try that trail the next year. Also, because it's in mountains, the weather could be completely crazy, or it could be super nice, sunny all the time, and you have to prepare for everything. So we were quite lucky, because it was warm, it was most of the days, it was sunny or partly sunny, and only I think in 2 or 3 days there was a little bit of rain during the day, and in 2 nights there was completely horrible, super strong wind and very, very strong rain. And that was completely crazy. I've never seen anything like that in Europe, anywhere else apart of tornado here, but it took houses and cars, so that's a bit different. But the weather is, and also 2 weeks after we left at the end of July, there is snow already. Now it's end of August and there is snow in most of the trail. There is snow, and it's way below zero in the night, and it's in the middle of the summer. So because of this, you have to be really prepared, and you have to take warm clothes, warm sleeping bag, good tent, because I think that not good tent won't survive those super strong winds or super strong rains and thunderstorms. So yeah, weather is definitely something you should be prepared for on this trail. So yeah, as I said, because it's in high mountains, the good time to do the Tour de Mont Blanc is basically only July and August. Some people go on late June, but you have to take crampons and you have to take much more clothes, because it can be cold and it's covered by snow. Even around on the trail, it's snow and ice there, so you have to take equipment for that. But usually from half of July till the end of August, there is no snow. Like, there are exceptions, like right now when there is a lot of snow and very cold, but usually it's not. So the best time to hike Tour de Mont Blanc, definitely July and August. On the other hand, those are the months when they are the most people, so yeah. As for difficulty, it's I don't know how to describe it. Most people say that it's very difficult trail, and that's because of elevation, because there is, I think, over 11,000 meters elevation gain on the whole trail, and the same down. Which means, depends on your speed, but if you are walking at least 20-25 kilometers per day, there is nearly 2000 meters elevation gain every day, and the same going down, which basically means that it's like when you would be walking up the stairs with your backpack for 3 or 4 hours straight. So imagine walking up the stairs with your full backpack on the sun for 3 hours, and then you are going for 3 hours down, and then you are going three hours up. So it's not difficult trail, it's tiring trail. I wouldn't say that it's difficult, because even when everyone says that it's difficult, there are no danger parts or, you know, technically difficult parts. If you don't take some optional road, then there could be, but on the main road, main trail, there is nothing difficult. There are no, you know, some ferrets or very super steep, you know, rocks or whatever. It's easy trail, but it's tiring. It's very tiring because of the elevation gain. Yeah, so I think the you don't need experiences. You need to be in good shape. But they were people, elderly people walking that trail. They were just slower, so they made it in 12, 13, 14 days. You take it slowly. You make 15 kilometers per day, and you are fine. You just need more time for it. I read articles that people died there, that they fell somewhere. We saw on our own eyes that there was a helicopter taking someone who fell from the rock, and they were just taking him, you know, in those, carrying him and taking him by the helicopter. But I can't imagine from my experience there how this can happen, because it's very safe. But yeah, there are some deaths. People are dying there for some reason. Maybe they are taking some dangerous roads, or they are just not careful enough. As for the location, you start usually people start in Les Houches, I think it's pronounced like that, in France, and you go anti-clockwise. That's what was suggested. And as I said, you go from France to Italy to Switzerland and back through France. The views are quite similar in Italy and France, but in Switzerland, I was very disappointed about Switzerland. The views weren't that good there, apart from a few places. Most of the part of Switzerland, you are just walking through forests. But also, I didn't like the attitude of locals. Like, I don't know that it's a thin ice to talk about this, but, you know, our car broke in Switzerland, and they charged us 10 times more than that's usual price. 10 times more, not twice or three times, which would be bad already, but 10 times. And, you know, the highway ticket you can't buy for 10 days like everywhere else in Europe. You have to buy 1 year ticket. You can't sleep, you can't wild camp in Switzerland. You have to use those paid campsites, and they are not cheap. There was one for 40 euros. And for 40 euros, you just get the place for a tent and the shower and the toilet. So it's ridiculously expensive. And not mentioning food in Switzerland. I paid for the cheapest vegan food, 40 euros. And it was nothing special. It was just potatoes with some vegetable. So yeah, I'm quite disappointed about Switzerland. But I'm sure that on other places it's nicer. And when I'm talking about the food, it's everywhere. You can really eat everywhere. You don't have to have any, you know, stocks with you, and you don't have to have to carry a lot. But if you are vegan, it's completely different story. And it was actually the worst experience I had on a trail in Europe, because like in Italy, they were laughing at me, and they were saying like, look where you are in Italy. We are cheese nation, you know, and the same in France and in Switzerland. So there was very, very, very little to eat there if you wanted to eat in restaurants and bars. I have very good experience with one refugee in refugee de la Balme in France. It was somewhere close to the beginning, maybe first or second day. They had super good vegan options and super, super good meals for okay price, so that I can recommend. But other than that, it will be very hard if you are vegan to eat on the trail to the Mont Blanc, although there are shops and restaurants everywhere. They just don't offer anything like that. There is cheese and milk and meat everywhere in everything. Yep. But with water, it's much better. First of all, like I said, they are campsites and refugees and shops everywhere. So it's super easy to get water. And on top of that, they are springs, natural springs, on most parts. So basically, all you need to carry is like 1 liter of water. It saves a lot of weight because you need really like 1 liter of water. And if you have a filter, you can get water basically everywhere. It's super convenient with water under the Mont Blanc. So if you are not vegan, you can save like 4 kilos in your backpack, because you don't have to carry any food. You can buy it everywhere and you need just 1 liter of water. So it's super lightweight, and that's actually good for this trail, because on this trail you have to be super lightweight, because heavy backpack means much more tiring walking into those very steep hills. Yeah, and as for prices and money, prices are higher obviously than anywhere else because it's so popular. But you don't need Swiss francs. Even in Switzerland, you can pay by euros everywhere. So I think if you wild camping or you are sleeping in those campsites, I don't know, maybe 200 euros. I think I spent like 100 euros for the whole trail. If you take 200, maybe 300 is more than enough. In some campsites, I think in Switzerland, the last campsite, they don't take card. So you have to have some cash. But everywhere else you can pay by card, just with euros. Super easy, super convenient, but expensive. There are many nice animals there. We saw ibexes, marmots. Those are super cute marmots. They are squeeing all the time, and you can hear them. And they don't run away. They are super curious, so they are just coming, you know, for few meters distance, and they are looking, and they are super curious. They are sheep, and about sheep, what I read was that they are very aggressive dogs on the Tour du Mont Blanc, which is such a bullshit, because they are many sheep, and with those sheep they are guard dogs, and those guard dogs their whole purpose is to take care of the sheep. And when you are walking by the sheep, they are barking at you, but they are not attacking, you know, like people are saying, like, he's going to bite you, he's very angry, and he's going just jump, he's just a few meters, and he's so barking, and he looks so aggressive. But no, all what the dog is doing is that telling you, don't go closer, those sheep, they are mine, I'm protecting them, I'm their king, don't do anything to harm my sheep, and that's it. So yeah, there is a barking dog which looks very aggressive and very angry, but he's not. Just ignore him and just walk around, and he will not attack you. They never attack people. And I can't imagine how people can say that it's dangerous because aggressive dogs. No, it's not. Just walk on the trail, don't go over those fences, and don't go to those sheep. Also, there are cows which are free there, like mostly free. Of course, there are some fences, but they have very big place, to walk freely, which was also very nice. It was on many places. So, yeah, I like this trail because of animals there, but less because of many people there. Yeah, but it makes sense because it's a very beautiful trail, so obviously there are more people, they want to see the beauty of this area. And yeah, and you see, it's called Tour de Mont Blanc because you are basically hugging the mountain all the time. You are there's a mountain, the Tour de Mont Blanc, and you are just walking like this around, so you see it all the time on your left side. And it's all the time under the snow, so those views, those vistas are really nice because of that. You are there in short sleeves and on the sun, it's 25 degrees, but next to you, like literally next to you, there is a mountain covered by snow. As for navigation, it's very easy to get there. In Les Houches, I think that, I know that there are few free parking lots which are just for hikers. So you can leave the car there and it's safe. And also the navigation through the trail is very easy because it's very well marked. You see marks everywhere. Maps are really good. You can get paper maps. It's very well marked on the internet, in offline maps and navigations. So you can't get lost. I think it's the first trail in my life where I haven't taken any wrong turn, you know, that I didn't have to walk back anywhere. It's very well marked, and also what's super surprising for me is that it's everywhere it's very clean. Like, there are 10,000 hikers every year and you don't see any trash anywhere. You see people everywhere, but you don't see any trash, any rubbish, nothing. It's super clean. I don't know how this is possible, because on other trails, when there are just few hundred people, there is so much trash and so much rubbish, but here it's not. So this is really nice and super surprising. I don't know how this happens. Maybe there is someone who is cleaning everything and taking rubbish after people. But really, it's very, very nice and very clean. So I don't know what more to say. It's just a mountain hike, very nice one. It's called the most beautiful trail in Europe, which, I don't know, it was very nice, but I don't know if it was the most beautiful, but it was very nice. I think that everyone who likes long distance hiking has to walk this hike. Like, it's mandatory, you have to have this experience. Those views are like not anywhere else. So I really liked it, but because of so many people, I wouldn't walk it again. I would choose something maybe in Italy. Those Dolomites, if you take some roads there, you can be basically alone. Or in Austria, or in Slovenia, like Giuliana Trail in Slovenia is totally awesome, and there are not that many people. But it doesn't mean that the hike, the Tour de Mont Blanc, wasn't nice. It was beautiful, very nice, challenging, and really, really good. So I highly recommend this one. So, yeah. My next hike, I'm going back to Mallorca, where I want to take the coastal hike, because on Mallorca the typical trail is GR221, where you go through mountains, and I made my own trail around the coast. So that's my next destination. Looking forward for it, and looking forward for another mountain hike in Dolomites.